you've been discussing linear algebra. So we saw how it's possible to go from vectors and define a more abstract vector space. So before we go further, we'll go back to the usual kind of vectors. Maybe we'll adopt this strategy from time to time. Whenever we want to introduce a new concept, or when possible, we will step back and look at familiar vectors, look at a concept from there and see how that particular concept can be generalized. So today in this lecture, we're going to look at the notion of a dot product. Okay, so the dot product, we are all familiar, is just defined as like in this notation here, A dot B is just the magnitude of A times magnitude of B times cosine of the angle between them, right? For 3D vectors, this is how we are used to thinking about it. Right, so one way to see this is actually to invoke the cosine law, right? So, you have to consider some triangle ABC. So we know that the sides AB, BC, and CA can be related with the angle theta, right? One of the angles, I'm taking it to be angle ABC to be theta, right? So we know that the vector AB plus vector BC is equal to vector AC, right? So now if you take this, the dot product of the left hand side with itself and the right hand side with itself, so you have AB plus BC dotted with AB plus BC is equal to AC dotted with AC, and then we expand, and so we have AB dot AB plus BC dot BC and plus BC dot AB plus AB dot BC, both of them are understood to be the same, so that's plus 2 times AB dot BC is equal to AC dot AC. And then we push all these terms involving just the magnitude squares to the right hand side. So then we are just left with AB dot BC, right? Is equal to half of, the modulus squared of, one side minus the modulus squared of another side minus the modulus squared of the third side, right? So we identify the left hand side as really the quantity that we are interested in. The dot product between two vectors is just the magnitude of each of these sides times cosine theta, which comes from the cosine law of triangles, right? So one could either, if one already accepted this expression as the dot product, one could use this as a way to get to the cosine law, but we have an independent way of getting to the cosine law. So this is like an argument for why the dot product of two vectors is given by this expression, right? So the geometric interpretation of this is of course, to think of this as the product of the magnitude of one vector times the projection of one on top of the other. So this is easy enough to see once you're already familiar with it. But it's not a priori obvious why this type of an operation should be the same in one direction or the other, right? You could as well do a projection in the other direction, but there's a way to geometrically also see that, if you were to project B on top of A or A on top of B, you would still get the same, right? One way to see this is to just take the dot product between the directions, then you have equal lengths, and then you can use a symmetry argument, and then the magnitudes simply will multiply, right? So that is one way to see why you'll get the same answer if you project one vector on top of the other, or if you were to project the other vector on top of the first, right? So there is another way of thinking of the dot product, which also we are all familiar with, which is to, if you know the components, right? I'm thinking of three-dimensional vectors, and this also is amenable to generalization to, arbitrary dimension, as long as they are Euclidean vectors, right? Then you can think of this as A dot B is AX, BX plus AY, BY plus AZ, BZ plus more components, if there are more components, right? So let's keep this in mind as we generalize these ideas to, more abstract vectors. They don't have to be Euclidean vectors. we have seen that the idea of vectors is much more general than these familiar kind of vectors, right? But before we generalize the notion of a dot product to the more abstract kind of vectors, let's look at how the fact that you have a this the notion of a dot product itself can be exploited in clever ways, right? Again, I'm going to give you an example from high school geometry, and there are many other similar problems which are elegantly solved using vectors. So let's look at one such example. So the point is that when two vectors are orthogonal to each other, we exploit the fact that their dot product is going to be zero, right? So the statement of the problem that we wish to prove is that if you were to drop a median of an isosceles triangle to the base, then that's going to be perpendicular to the base, right? Surely you have seen this statement at some point of time, and you must have used some pure geometry methods to prove this, right? So let's look at how, with the aid of the dot product, we can do it rather quickly and elegantly using vectors. So we have this triangle ABC, right? And I am joining, so we are given that ABC is an isosceles triangle with AB equal to AC, right? BC is the base, and I'm going to drop this median from A to the midpoint of BC, right? And now let's look at the dot product between the vector AP and BC. So I have AP dot BC is equal to AB plus half BC dot BC, right? So what is AP? It is AB plus half of BC, right? But what is BC itself? I can rewrite BC as AC minus AB. So I have AB plus half of AC minus AB. The whole thing is going to be dotted with the vector BC, right? So then I can collect these terms together. So I have AB plus half AC minus half AB, which is the same as half of AB plus AC. So if you look at this, carefully, you see from symmetry, what we are saying is this AP is nothing but half of AB plus AC, which is how you would expect it to be, right? So it's just because you have dropped this line from A to the midpoint of BC. And then you also have dotted with AC minus AB. So far, all of this would be true for any triangle. We have not exploited the fact that this is an isosceles triangle, right? But we can go ahead and expand this. Then we have AB dot AC minus AC dot AB, right? So which will cancel, and then you have AB dot AC dot AC minus AB dot AB, half of AC dot AC minus AB dot AB. All of this up till this point is true for any triangle, but now comes the crucial point. So which is that the magnitude of AB is the same as the magnitude of AC. So these two terms will just cancel, and then you get a zero, right? So that's a quick and elegant way to prove that. So what we have managed to show is that this median AP is perpendicular to the base BC, because the dot product of AP with BC is zero, right? So that's what we managed to prove using vectors. Now, in this discussion that we have had so far, we have tacitly assumed many properties of the dot product. So let's just summarize these properties, right? So in fact, it is these properties that we are primarily concerned with, because we are interested in how to generalize this notion of a dot product to a linear vector space, right? So let's write it down, right? So you have, first of all, we have already repeatedly used the fact that A dot B is equal to B dot A, right? Which is a symmetric property, which we are so accustomed to, so used to, that we think that it's obvious, right? But when we go to the linear vector space, and when we introduce the notion of a scalar product there, we will see that we have to tweak this a little bit. It's not so straightforward, right? So there is a modification that we will have to work with. So let's keep this in mind. So here for Euclidean vectors, it's completely symmetric. A dot B is equal to B dot A. And then the dot product of a vector with itself is always greater than 0, unless it's a 0 vector itself. If it is a 0 vector, then its magnitude is 0. So the dot product of a 0 vector with itself is, of course, just 0. So in general, the dot product of a vector with itself has a measure of the magnitude of the vector, right? And it better be a positive quantity. So in fact, so we write this as, if so A dot A is always greater than or equal to 0, it's a number and it's a real number whose value is greater than or equal to 0, and so we use the square root of this A dot A as the magnitude. We know that it's the magnitude of the vector, right? So this is also one of the properties. Then of course, if you take the dot product of any vector with the 0 vector, you just get 0, right? So, and also an important rule that we tacitly assume in all these operations is the so-called distributive law, right? If you take some arbitrary linear combination of two vectors, and if you take the dot product of some other vector with this linear combination of vectors, then it's going to be, you know, these coefficients will just come out, and then you can take these dot products with these various vectors that constitute this overall vector alpha b plus beta c. So you get, when you take a dot product with a, you'll get alpha a dot b plus beta a dot c, right? So all these properties we want to keep, or the, you know, the best possible way in which you know, these properties can be generalized, we want to you know, keep them when we define the notion of a scalar product between vectors in a linear vector space, which will be the subject matter of the next lecture. Thank you.